about some of his interesting work simulating and evaluating the coherent Ising machine. So,
thank you. It was nice to be back in Louisiana. Despite growing up on the North Shore, I've never actually been to UNO before, so thanks for having me.
Welcome. You can see Lake Pontchartrain now. So.
Yeah. Well, I've seen the lake by your time. Just to clarify, I'm at the University of Texas. I'm at a place called ARL Applied Research Laboratories, and we are we're an administrative unit about the same level as like the College of Science, but I'm not actually on the main campus or within the College of Science. We're parallel, and we're a like grant and government funded research center. Called a UARC, University Affiliated Research Center. So administratively, we are part of UT. You know, I'm a State of Texas employee, but if you look up professors or faculty at UT, you won't see me, you won't see my supervisor, Brian LeCour, but we're really there, just a few miles north of UT, within Austin. This research project that we're working on, here's my name, Josie Hainish. Gave a presentation on this at Squint a couple months ago. She's a really talented undergrad in our group. And then we started this project with Antia Lamas-Linares. She was an employee at the Texas Advanced Computing Center, which is on the same campus as ARL, part of UT. And I'll tell you a little bit about coherent Ising machines. The idea is that we're going to be trying to solve an Ising problem. A lot of you are probably familiar with the Ising model. Basically, you have a Hamiltonian that's given by the sum of some interaction terms between spins, and then a sum over some external field term for spins. Most of the time, we take this little h to be zero. The reason being that if as h gets big, that dominates over the coupling terms, and then it becomes very easy to solve. If you think about, you know, a bunch of spins just sitting in a very strong external magnetic field, that would be this little h, and then it doesn't really matter how the spins are coupled. If this field is big compared to the coupling, then the preferred energy state is just going to be aligned with the field, or anti-aligned with the field, depending on the sign. Solving this Ising problem is an NP-complete optimization problem, and so it's a good model for a few reasons. One is because it's physically relevant to, you know, it looks like a common theoretical model for solids. And then the other is that in polynomial time, we can map other NP problems to this one. So if we can solve this one, ideally we can solve any NP problem. As an example, and this is a common kind of toy model, we'll take anti-ferromagnetic ring. So that means that the coupling between any two neighbor spins is negative one, and the coupling between non-neighbor spins is zero. So this would be the J matrix. This is the coupling matrix for this particular problem. And this is just like a four-spin ring. So it's pretty straightforward, but playing with these straightforward models can give you a lot of insight, and also it's a good way to test if your simulation is working correctly before you put in something really hard that you don't know the problem or don't know the answer to. Also, just to clarify, this J matrix, or this J matrix, basically fully characterizes the problem. So when I say that in polynomial time you can map an NP problem to the Ising model, what I'm really saying is that you can figure out what this J matrix would be for some problem. And then the spins, this SI and SJ, the spin state, gives you the solution to the problem. Coherent Ising machine. A lot of people have asked me, what is the coherent Ising machine? So this is a great diagram to show what it is. Basically, you have some source laser, you split it up, and here you get second harmonic generation into a pump, which then through this PPLN gets, you know, converted back into the original frequency. That may seem kind of like a crazy thing to do, but works here. And then this is some optical oscillator, an optical ring. So you get time-separated pulses of this are circulating within this ring. And at each lap, here a little bit is split off. And we take a little bit of that split off, or that little bit that's split off, and do a homodyne measurement on it. And based on the outcome of that measurement, or we feed the outcome of that measurement in to this FPGA. And the FPGA is a field programmable gate array. It's a classical computer that calculates basically the interaction terms between the different spins. So that J matrix that I mentioned is entered into here, and it figures out the coupling between all the spins. Based on that coupling, it gives a signal to this bit, which is taking from this original pump laser, or the original source laser, and calculates a feedback term and adds it back in. And there's some precise timing so that the spin, you know, A2, as it passed here, makes one loop. And as it's passing here again, it gets this little feedback kick. And we get a feedback for every spin. I'm calling these pulses spins because that's what we're simulating, but every pulse, if you will. And you do this a bunch of times, and over time, ideally, these feedback kicks are putting these spin pulses into the solution state. So what we're really doing, analogous to annealing of a crystal, is we're starting in some largely disordered state and then allowing the spins to interact with one another until they kind of anneal into a low energy state. And so this is a model of physical annealing. So some metrics of performance, a very obvious one is success probability. How many times do we get the right answer divided by the total times we tried to get the right answer? So that's just a percentage. Time to solution is another metric of performance. This gives you, this is the time that it takes to complete the simulation divided by log 0.01 over 1 minus log of 1 minus success probability. And this tan is the least time that it can take to get the solution. And the smallest of that is T min. So if this is the number, or if this is the time it takes for all the spins to complete one loop around the circulator, then in the number of spins times the number of round trips divided by the pump frequency gives you that time. And this is just, you know, if you use dimensional analysis, this is just how long does it take for it to circulate. And then your steps to solution, this gives you a good way to compare between different physical models or between different computer simulations, because, you know, if I run it on my laptop and then Antia runs it at the supercomputer at Tech, pretty obviously hers is going to get the answer first, but did it do better or did it just throw a lot more processing power? If we go to steps to solution, then we can compare those across platform. And then another idea that we've had for metric of performance is just near ground state probability. So what if we don't find the actual ground state, but we find a pretty good approximate ground state? That's acceptable for some problems. So this is another thing that we can look at to decide how well our simulation is doing. Some various approaches for solving the Ising problem. Brute force, that one's easy, just try every spin combination. The problem is that takes, you know, n squared number of attempts, and as n grows, that gets really, really tough. There's this Colm spin server, University of Cologne, as they call it, Big Mac. You can go to this website and enter some problem or use their generator problems, and it gives you a solution. They call it exact. It doesn't give you all the solutions, but it will give you one solution of the ground state. There are some classical algorithms, noise and mean field annealing, which we'll look at some more, parallel tempering, and stochastic master equation that we'll look at also. and then hardware solutions, coherent Ising machine that we're talking about, and the D-wave annealer, I'm sure you've heard of it. These are possible ways of solving this particular problem. So noise and mean field annealing algorithm that I mentioned, it's informed by the model of the coherent Ising machine, and King et al. Put out this paper last year. There's kind of some back and forth between the groups that are proponents of the coherent Ising machine and the D-wave groups, because they're kind of parallel and in some ways very similar hardware solutions to the same problem. So there's a bit of like a friendly rivalry going on between them. And so the D-wave group developed this noise and mean field annealing algorithm that you just run on your own computer or on a nice server farm somewhere. Basically, you take a measurement of the spins, compute how they should interact. You come up with some mean field that you're going to add back into the spins. You combine it, then you iterate at the time. How have the spins changed? We'll take a measurement, compute the interaction again, combine it. And you know, that's basically what the CIM is doing, just in hardware. If we look at running this noisy mean field annealer against the CIM, you can see in some places there's kind of similar results. This is all taken from this King paper. But there's a lot of variability, so the means are close, but sometimes there's a big change in the success probability. And here for a different problem, so this is a fully connected, just random all-to-all coupling, SK is Sherrington-Kirkpatrick. And then for dense max cut, this is a particular NP problem. And again, you can see there's huge variability, and it's kind of alternating up and down with the NMFA, which is kind of interesting. Normally, you would expect as the problem size grows, it would be harder to solve the problem. But since each of these is a particular instance, then adding, you know, a few to n is not necessarily solving the exact same problem with more spins. It's solving something within the same family of problems, just with more spins. So that's part of where all the variability comes from as well. This ring is called a Mobius ladder. It's very similar to the anti-ferromagnetic ring, except that now the spins across from one another are coupled, and in this case they're anti-coupled, but they could be possibly coupled as well. It's just another common toy problem, and now using the algorithm given by King in this paper, this is a simulation that we've performed. And so what I'm showing here on this axis is the value of the spin, and on this axis is the iterations or the steps that we're taking. And what you can see basically that we start all the spins around a mean of zero, and as time marches on, they bifurcate. We get some of them going up and some of them going down, until at the end we have basically all of them are either pointing down or pointing up. So this is the structure that we want out of our simulation. We want to start with a disordered state and march forward in time and end up with an ordered state. And then at the end we have to look at this ordered state and say, well, is it the right ordered state? And for a problem like this, it's easy because if everyone is pointing the opposite of its neighbor, you know that's the right answer. So again, we play with these toy models a lot. This is for all-to-all integer coupling. So this is now where, you know, spin I, pick a random number to couple it to J, to spin J. And of course this matrix is symmetric across the diagonal, so spin 1 and 2 interacts the same as spin 2 and 1. And so this is for 40 spins using the noisy mean field annealing algorithm. And here it's real ugly, like this blue one you can see comes down and then goes back up. So it's really not clear what's going to happen until you get a wide separation between the two ends. But it does, in the end, bifurcate and give us some answer. And then this is the Ising energy as a function of time. And so you can see here at this very disordered state, it has a very high energy, because what the capital H is for that Ising Hamiltonian. And by this point at 400, you can see it doesn't look good, but the energy is already very low. And really, the bulk of the spins are here and here, with just a few in the middle that haven't decided yet which way to go. So you can see it pretty quickly gets close to the ground state energy, and then ends up basically at the ground state energy. And in this case, we did find the ground state energy at 380 energy units. So success probability. For a dense max cut problem, as the number of spins increases, it stays pretty constant. This is kind of an outlier, but it does happen. You know, sometimes you just get a bad bunch of runs or a particularly difficult problem. But it's relatively constant, and then it goes kind of wild over here. And for this same problem, if you look, so this is for 90 spins. If we expand the data that we used to find the success probability for 90 spins, the ground state energy was minus 638, which we get, you know, with 10%, 11%. But there were a lot of, or sorry, not 11%, 11 runs, 1%, because this is out of 1,000. There are a lot of relatively close to the ground state energy results, but they did not get the right answer. They just got, you know, within, say, 20 of the right answer. So kind of close, a few percent off, but not the right answer. And that's kind of a hallmark that we'll see of a lot of these annealing algorithms. The Mobius ladder, again, it has this funny up and down structure. As the problem size increases, the success probability is generally decreasing as problem size increases, but not strictly decreasing. And then for random all-to-all integer couplings, you know, for small, it's okay. As soon as you get big, you're kind of all over the place. So, and just to be clear, these small problems are not the ones that we want to solve with an annealer. We want to solve the big problems. The small ones we can already do with classical computers. what we're trying to do is improve on those capabilities. Okay. Just throwing a lot of data at you here. These are success probabilities.
Are these success probabilities?
Maybe this is mislabeled. Yeah, this is mislabeled. I'm sorry. These are the ground state energy, or the energies that we find at the end of the runs for different problem sizes. And so just to start with, n equals 70, that's what this column is. And you know, a common complaint about this slide might be that this x scale is different than this x scale. That's because this is a different problem than this, so it would not necessarily make sense because the ground state point is not the same as the ground state point here. There are arguments in each direction, but this is the creative choice that we made. Anyway, for a random all-to-all coupling here, we got a large amount in the ground state, not very many in the second state, or the second lowest energy, and then a large amount in the third lowest energy. And that's kind of common here, a large in the ground state, but a lot elsewhere. Same here. Here, not the highest probability in the ground state, but a whole lot relatively close to the ground state, and here as well. So we're seeing close to ground state energy, but not really ground state energy with high probability. An idea for describing the CIM in a more quantum way was given, this is an equation given by the Yamamoto group, and this is a master equation, so here rho would be some density matrix representing the state that you start with, so all the spins that you put in, the laser, the pump. So the terms of interest, this is the spin system, this is a pump, this is the feedback term for the spin system, this is the feedback term for the pump, or this is the strength of the pump laser, this is the generation of the spins, and this is some noise introduced by the homodyne measurements. And looking at a few of these, so this is kind of difficult to mess around with. There are a few different ways we can go. One is the stochastic differential equation, where we use the positive P representation. I don't know how familiar you are with quantum optics. This is very similar to the Sudarshan P representation. We're basically using pseudo probabilities to represent the density matrix. And this is worked out. I didn't come up with this. And it's covered very thoroughly in Carmichael's quantum optics book. But basically, this alpha and beta are giving us the values of the spins, or the terms of interest for the spins. And then a different approximation would be the Gaussian approximation. Here we're looking at the average value of the spin and then the variance. And so these are the variables that we're going to track for different approximations of this. And again, you get this bifurcation. So this is very simple. This is two spins, anti-ferromagnetic coupling. You can flip a coin and get this right half the time. But you see it starts at zero and then at some point splits up. And again, for a different version of it, the same thing. So this is Gaussian and this is the stochastic equation. And this is given by the Yamamoto group, their own simulations. And for low numbers of spins, this works very, very well. As you increase the number of spins, it gets more interesting to look at, but it still tends to bifurcate and solve the problem in some way. So this is for 8 spins, 24, and 80, and it has this kind of hallmark shape that starts at zero and splits up and down. I really like at larger spin numbers, you get like a SIP lightning or something going on there. But the success probabilities are not great. So even though here it has found a solution, the solution that it finds is not the right answer. It's just some relatively low energy state. And so what these success probabilities are showing you, up here is one. And for the Gaussian, you really almost never get one or even close to one as the number of spins increases. And for this is for a max cut for all-to-all couplings. Got one a couple of times here, very close to it. But basically, this is not a reliable simulation technique. The stochastic differential equations give you a little bit better at small problem sizes, but again, you don't have, out here by 70, you're looking at like 20%, and that's not acceptable if this is going to take significant computing power. And for all-to-all coupling, so this is just some generalizing problem, out at large spin systems, it's a very small percentage that you're actually getting the right answer. Now, if this was easy to run quickly, then maybe 15% would be all right because you can just run it 8 times, take the lowest number, and there's a pretty good likelihood that you'll get it. But if this is already taking on the order of how long it takes a classical simulation, then you're not really seeing any computational improvement if you have to run it 8 times. And this is only for on the order of 100 spins. As we increase to very interesting, 1,000 spin problems, the likelihood of getting the ground state is not very high. And this is just to compare the noisy mean field annealing algorithm that I presented at the very beginning. This totally classical algorithm has a significantly higher success probability almost all the way through for both the max cut and for the all-to-all couplings. So you can see if this is the answer that we're getting for 110 spins, and this is the new way of doing it, there's not a really great reason to use the new way. So again, I'm just showing now, this is like what I showed before, the energies that you do get, where all the way on the left of each one is the ground state, and these are all near ground state. So you do get a very large probability of getting a near ground state answer, but not a very good probability of getting the actual ground state. And this is for, this is the Gaussian ODEs, and this is the stochastic ODEs that I showed using the positive P representation. What are we looking at for the CIM? It uses classical hardware. Remember I said that it used an FPGA. So all of the feedback is classical anyway. This isn't even really a quantum annealer. It's using quantum spins, but they're not interacting in any quantum way. It's inspired some classical algorithms that you can run on your own computer. And those outperform the actual CIM and also the master equations inspired by the CIM that the Yamamoto group has come up with. And then when you're doing the CIM master equations, the simplifications that use more physics terms perform better. And what I mean by that is that the stochastic ODE that I showed generally did better than the Gaussian ODE. And that's maybe to be expected because it's less of an abstraction. But at the same time, it uses a lot of computational resources, and if we can use this noisy mean field annealing algorithm, and by the way, that's not optimized, that's just some algorithm that they spit out. It's really as simple as I described. Take a measurement, calculate a number, add it back in. That's not really taking advantage of any hardware. And in fact, Fujitsu and working with Microsoft have come up with some hardware that runs basically noisy mean field annealing, but it's purpose-built, it's like an ASIC, and they run significantly faster than even the optimized algorithm running on GPUs and everything. So purpose-built hardware that's totally classical kind of blows all of this out of the water. So where are we going with this? Here's an idea as far as finding near ground state energies. If you just artificially reduce the noise, now this is unphysical because all I've done here is turn down the noise that's introduced by homodyne measurement, and there is some necessary meter process that is going to contribute to this. So all I've done is kind of suppress that because it's a computer, I can do what I want. This is the ground state, so this is the optimal answer for this problem, and these are the four lowest energy states. And by turning down the noise, I've eliminated this fourth lowest and push all the probability into these. So it hasn't really increased the probability of finding the ground state. Here's 9.5%, it's about 9.5%. But it has increased the probability of finding the second lowest and the third lowest. So this is an idea, if we can somehow turn down the noise, maybe we can get an approximate solution better. And then that pushes you towards, okay, can we actually do it in a quantum way? You know, I said that this was all through an FPGA. Can we make the spins interact quantumly? The most naive idea of making these interact in a quantum way is to take this this master equation. Now this is the feedback term, and then this is the term that has the noise that I mentioned. So these are where the classical parts are introduced. You know, here's the, this has to do with the homodyne measurement, this has to do with the feedback. So if I take this feedback term, this epsilon si, and it's calculated by a quadrature measurement. If instead of using the actual measurement, I just put the quadrature operator in there, okay? What does that mean physically? That's not what I'm here to describe. I'm just talking about some ideas. Given this equation that Yamamoto has said describes his machine, how can I tweak it and try to make it act more like a classical thing? I mean, more like a quantum thing, sorry. And then, again, all I was doing here was scaling this dwdt so that this contributed either more or less as it progressed. And so by just turning the quadrature measurement into a quadrature operator and then running this for an anti-ferromagnetic two-spin ring, so all we want at the end is for them to start at the beginning and then end up pointing in opposite directions, and run it very naively, you can see, okay, it basically gives the right answer most of the time. This is debatable whether this is gonna be the right answer. I mean, at the end of the simulation, it's the right answer, but very shortly before the simulation, it was not the right answer. And so, while this is, you know, promising, I guess, because you've got 5 out of 6 runs, and this is representative, so about 5/6 of the time, it gives you the right answer. 1/6 of the time, it's debatable whether you get the right answer or not. This is for the simplest problem that we can give it, you know? We want 2 spins to end up pointing opposite directions. This is better than flipping a coin, but it also takes significantly more computing resources than flipping a coin. So we need a better model if we want this quantum coherent Ising machine to actually give us any results, or if we can make a more realistic model of spin interactions, we can find out will the quantum coherent Ising machine give any results, or is it not really worth dedicating time to this when we can just maybe push forward the true universal quantum Turing machine efforts instead? So with that, I'm done. I'd like to thank you and acknowledge my sponsors. I work at ARL. We're paid for this project by the AFRL, Air Force Research Lab, and then we used